everybody, and welcome to an introduction to Key Stage 1 history. Okay, so one of the first things we do with history is to get the children to have an understanding of the passing of time. So this could start with simple questions such as, tell me what you did yesterday, at home, at school, what are you going to do tomorrow, what are you going to do at the weekend? So we then talk about words such as last week, next week, past, future, and now. So they have an understanding that history, yes, is about our past. It's also talking about how our actions and our choices, what's going on right now, and how this might affect the future. So we often start with then ordering a simple time sequence such as life cycles, human, frog, butterfly, and understanding particularly that they need to use words such as first, next, then, later, after, finally. So having lots of practice with these different sorts of animal and human life cycles and comparing these events and different stages of life to each other, so that a tadpole comes before the frog, that the frog comes after the froglet. So all this type of language and practice. So the next thing I do is get the children to have a look at maybe three or four events and to then order them. So four things I tend to pick on are an image of dinosaurs, because children have a good understanding that it was far, far in the past. Today's date, today's year, the year zero is a marking point, and we'll go on to how we use that as a timeline, and then the year of their birth, depending on how old they are. So often that I'll then get the children to have a go at ordering these. Usually they have a good understanding that today's date is the most recent, that a few years ago they were born, that our year zero is much further, and when you need to explain to the dinosaurs were several millions of years ago, they can then usually work out this order. It's then about describing and using the words we talked about earlier, such as first, next, last. So asking them questions. What came first? What is the most recent? What came before you were born? Could be more than one answer. What is the final event or object in our time sequence or our timeline? So we then start introducing, now we've put into this year zero, we start introducing more technical chronological vocabulary. So we introduced the year zero. Now, previous years, and how I actually learned when I was growing up, we would have had BC, so all the years before the year zero would be BC, so before Christ, and after would have been AD, Anno Domini. Okay, now we actually use new vocabulary, which is before the year zero is BCE, which is before the common era, and all dates after year zero is CE, which is common era. So the children need to know that on their number line, from the year zero going up to the present day, it's numbers increasing, so year one, year two, year 100, year 1200 going up, and equally the dates, bit like a thermometer scale, going in reverse. So we then have 1 year BCE, 1200 BCE, so our numbers are going in symmetrical pattern effectively both directions, so 1 1 2 2 both directions. Now, one of the key important things that when we talk about history and looking at artifacts and people from the past into is to encourage natural historical curiosity. So, for example, we might look at particular characters in history. So, for example, we might have somebody like a pirate, such as Edward Teach, Blackbeard, or maybe one of the Tudors, Stuarts, anything from the Apollo missions, any particular historical person. And what we ask the children to do is to really think about historical questions using such as what, when, how, why, when, okay? And actually encouraging the children to think about what questions would they like to investigate about this person, or what questions would they ask the person if they could, if they were alive today. Again, some of these historical figures, if you're researching a more recent historical figure, may be alive. Also then, we encourage the children to use the same idea. So if, for example, they had a historical object, so whether it was something that perhaps they could guess, or there is a similar facsimile to today's life, or something that's completely unknown. So actually asking historical questions about objects as well. And it's understanding that they can use multiple sources with support to answer these. So they might be able to use books, online, PowerPoints, posters, audio files, video files. So it's understanding that you can get a lot of answers, whether it is from visual clues or written clues as well. So they can ask and answer historical questions. When we study a particular historical period in time, for example, maybe pirates or the Tudors, what we often get the children to do is then to identify similarities and differences between the past and their lives now. Now, often the most easiest way of doing this is often comparing clothing styles, although sometimes with modern fashion there is some loop back to some old fashions that have come round again. Often then talking about modes of transport again, although the children have an interesting discussion about things like pirate ships, the fact there are still ships today, are they still the same design, why are all ships the same? We can also then describe things like their houses and homes, food, entertainment. This is a really good way for the children to understand quite how different some of the lives were between then and now, and actually how there are still some similarities between these different time periods. A nice challenge I love to give my children is to then infer whether they would have had an object or a particular artifact in a particular time. So, you know, it was dark in Henry VIII's Hampton Court Palace, so would he have got out a torch? No, why? So actually asking children to start inferring about materials and objects and maybe technological advancements that wouldn't have happened back then, and that's why these artifacts or objects or events wouldn't have happened back in time. So, when we do study particular historical key events, we like to think about, okay, what impact they would have had. So this may be a particular modern historical person, so in the children's lifespan that they know, or a particular event. So we could talk about obviously like the VE Day celebrations. For some children, it would have been when Great Britain last held the Olympics. And then things in living memory for perhaps like grandparents. So when we're thinking, and great-great-grandparents. So when we start looking at our British history, so Victorians, Civil Wars, things like that. And then also we look at world history. So we like to think about not only investigating these and seeing how they're connected to each other, but also seeing the impact of either particular people's choices and actions or particular events that happened. So we look at what was the impact of the Wright brothers' first flight? What would have happened if Martin Luther King hadn't put his effort into equality? How the rise and fall of the British Empire happened and what happened and the consequences because of this? How Britain is different because of the invasions of the Romans over the years, the engineering achievements of the Egyptians and how that affected the rest of the world or didn't, and outbreaks of world wars, the consequences and impact of these events. History is an absolutely vivid, imaginative place to actually do some research and study, and encourage your child to maybe pick a particular person or era or country that they wish to study, because there's a vast array of information out there to enjoy. Hope that helps.